That's a love bug relationship. It's not a Shabbat lesson, but I came across this knowledge bug relationship concerning us Jamaicans. So, you know what I mean? I would like to impart that knowledge so you can know what happened to our people during chapter slavery by the British. And like, let me reiterate again and again that our history did not start with slavery. It is a part of it. Our history started in scripture. Huh? We are the descendants of Shem. We have the seed of Jacob. You understand? And the promise extended to Abraham. You understand? Abraham was promised that his seed would be numerous as the sea and the stars. Huh? Shem is the blessed line. Jacob is the chosen seed. We are his offspring who went into slavery because of disobedience of our four parents. You see, we are royal people. We need to come back to these laws, commandments, and statutes, brothers and sisters. Right? It's one thing to know that you are ethnic, Hebrew, ethnic Israelite. Right? Culturally. That's not enough, brothers and sisters. Do you understand? That's not enough. How we became a set apart people is one, the most like Jesus first and made a covenant with our forefathers. Two, by keeping his laws, commandments, and statutes. That is why we were set apart, and that's why we are peculiar, because we follow the law. You see, so it's not just to know that you are Israelite, or you're from the 12 tribes, or one of the 12 tribes. It is all Negroes, by the way. I just want to point that out. Right? That's not enough, brothers and sisters. You see, you've got to do the work. You got to keep these laws, commandments, and statutes. Right? So, I'm going to title this video, The Punishment of the Israelites in Jamaica by the British. Right? The Punishment of the Israelites in Jamaica by the British, right? I have a video that after, you know, I like to do a lot of putting in context in scriptures, because everything is fulfilling according to scriptures. All world events that you see on the world stage is rooted in the fulfillment and prophecies of scriptures, brothers and sisters. Whether you believe or not, that's none of my concern. You see, Deuteronomy 28. Right, and it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of Yahuwah thy Elohim, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that Yahuwah thy Elohim will set thee on high above all nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee, if thou shalt hearken unto the voice of Yahuwah thy Elohim. Blessed shalt thou be in the city, and blessed shalt thou be in the field. Blessed shall be the fruit of thy body, and the fruit of thy ground, and the fruit of thy cattle, the increase of the kine, and the flocks of thy sheep. Blessed shall be thy basket and thy store. Blessed shalt thou be. Blessed shalt thou be when thou comest in, and blessed shalt thou be when thou goest out. Yahuwah shall cause thy enemies that rise up against thee to be smitten before thy face. They shall come out against thee one way and flee before thee seven ways. Yahuwah shall command the blessing upon thee in thy storehouses and in all that thou sittest thine hand unto. And he shall bless thee in the land which Yahuwah the Elohim giveth thee. Yahuwah shall establish thee an holy city unto himself, as he had sworn unto thee, if thou shalt keep the commandments of Yahuwah the Elohim and walk in his ways. and all the people of the earth shall see that thou art called by the name of Yahuwah, and they shall be afraid of thee. And Yahuwah shall make the plenteous in goods, in the fruit of thy body, in the fruit of thy cattle, in the fruit of thy ground, in the land which Yahuwah sware unto thy father to give thee. Yahuwah shall open unto thee his good treasures, the heavens to give the rain unto thy land in his season, and to bless all the work of thy hand, and thou shalt lend unto many nations, and thou shalt not borrow. Yahuwah shall make thee the head and not the tail, thou shalt be above only, and thou shalt not be beneath, if that thou hearken unto the commandments of Yahuwah thy Elohim, which I command thee this day to observe and to do them. And thou shalt not go aside from any of the words which I command thee this day, to the right hand or to the left, to go after other gods, to serve them, to go after other gods, to serve them. This is one of the reasons why we were sent into captivity many times. And you stiff-necked so-called black people today, whether we are scattered, still serving other gods. But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of Yahuwah thy Elohim, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. You see that? So from verse 1 to 15 in Deuteronomy 28, brothers and sisters. Right? From Deuteronomy 28, 1 to 15, the Most High outlined all the blessings will come upon us if we only come back to his laws, commandments, and statutes, and keeping them. You see, brothers and sisters, he outlined the blessings. Now watch what happens if we do not follow the commandments of the Most High. This is what the Most High said unto thee, stiff-necked Israel. Hebrews, the son of Hebrews, slaves. He set up the stage in verse 15, right? But it shall come to pass, right off the bat, the Most High said that this will happen. It shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of Yahuwah thy Elohim, to observe and to do all his commandments and his statutes which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. Cursed shall be thou in the city, and cursed shall thou be in the field. Cursed shall be thy basket and thy store. Cursed shall be the fruit of thy body, and the fruit of thy land, and the increase of thy kind, and the flock of thy sheep. Cursed shall thou be when thou comest in, and cursed shall thou be when thou goest out. Yahuwah shall send upon thee cursing, vexation, and rebuke in all that thou seest thine hand unto to do, until thou be destroyed, and until thou perish quickly because of the wickedness of thy doings, whereby thou art forsaken me. Is this not happening right now, brothers and sisters? Is this not happening right now, Yahweh, with the we are scattered? Yahuwah shall make the pestilence cleave unto thee, until he hath consumed thee from off the land whither thou goest to possess it. That's not happening to us right now. All the diseases among us, diabetes, hypertension, high blood pressure, heart disease, all manner of ailments. These are the pestilence, brothers and sisters. That's among Yashael. Yahuwah shall smite thee with a consumption, and with a fever, and with inflammation, and with extreme burning, and with sword, and with blasting, and with mildew, and they shall pursue thee until thou perish. And thy heaven that is over thy head shall be brass, and the earth that is under thee shall be iron. Yahuwah shall make the rain of thy land powder, and dust from heaven shall it come down upon thee until thou be destroyed. Yahuwah shall cause thee to be smitten before thine enemy. Thou shalt go out one way against him and flee seven ways before them, and shall be removed into all the kingdom of the earth. Is this not happening right now? Didn't this happen to us, brothers and sisters, when we were taken into slavery? The Lord calls, Yahuwah shall cause thee to be smitten before our enemies. That happened in slavery and after slavery and continue today. Thou shalt go one way against them and flee from the other way. That happened. And shall be removed into all the kingdom of the earth. We got removed from our land and be scattered in all the kingdoms of the earth, brothers and sisters. And thy carcass shall be meat unto all fowls of the air and unto the beasts of the earth, and no man shall pray them away. This happened. All the Hebrews, children of Yahshua, they throw overboard and leave on the earth. Birds and stuff eat them. Animals eat them, right? This fulfilled, right? Right? Yahuwah will smite thee with the butt of Eden, Mizrahim. And with hemorrhoids, and with the scab, and with the itch, whereof thou canst not be healed. Yahuwah shall smite thee with madness and blindness and astonishment of heart. It's happening. Physical blindness and spiritual blindness. And astonishment of heart. Fear. Police brutality. Thou shalt grope at noonday, and the blind gropeth. And thou shalt gropeth at noonday, and the blind gropeth in darkness, and thou shalt not prosper in the way, and thou shalt be only oppressed and spoiled evermore, and no man shall save thee. Thou shalt betroth a wife, and another man shall lie with her. Thou shalt build a house, and thou shalt not dwell therein. Thou planted a vineyard, and shalt not gather the grapes. This not happened to us in slavery. Yet we have learned nothing, right? Thy sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people, and then I shall look and fail with longing for them all the day long, and there shall be no might in thy hand. All these things took place in slavery. How they separated sons and the daughters from their parents and sell them to other people, brothers and sisters, other wicked colonial masters. Seed of Cain, brothers and sisters, and Japheth. The fruit of thine land and all thy labor shall a nation which thou knowest not eat up, and thou shalt be on your pitch and crushed always. So that thou shalt be mad for the sight of thine eyes which thou shalt see. Yahuwah shall smite thee in the knees and in the legs with a sore botch that cannot be healed, from the sole of thy foot unto the top of thy head. Yahuwah shall bring thee and thy king which thou shalt set over thee unto a nation which neither thou nor thy father have known, and there shall thou serve other gods, wood and stone. Is happening right now in the land of captivity, the king that you choose Caesar over Yahusha HaMashiach. You choose Rome over Yahuwah Tisifahot. And thou shalt become an astonishment, a proverb, and a byword among all nations which Yahuwah shall lead thee. Aren't we astonishment everywhere we go? People, I look at these people. We are proverbs, a byword. Huh? Call you also to me, right? Nick? Huh? Monkey? Huh? Hmm? These laws and prophecies are fulfilling in and around us. Yet you will not understand, yet you will not see, right? Hmm? Thou shalt carry much seed unto much. Thou shalt carry much seed out into the field and shall gather but little in, for the locust shall come and consume it. Thou shalt plant vineyard and dress them, but shall neither drink of the wine nor gather the grapes of the worms, or gather the grapes, for the worms shall eat them. Thou shalt have olive trees throughout all the coast, but thou shalt not anoint thyself with the oil, for thine olive shall cast his fruit. Thou shalt begat sons and daughters, but thou shalt not enjoy them, for they shall go into captivity. That happened during slavery. All thy trees and fruit of thine land shall the locusts consume. The strangers that is within thee shall get up above thee very high, and thou shalt come down very low. Ye shall lend to thee, and thou shalt not lend to him. Ye shall be the head, He shall be the head, and thou shalt be the tail. Alright, we the tail right now, brothers and sisters. Hmm? And they shall be upon thee for a sign and for a wonder, and upon thy seed forever, because thou servest not Yahuwah thy Elohim with joyfulness and with gladness of heart for the abundance of all things. Therefore shall thou serve thine enemies, which Yahuwah shall send against thee in hunger and thirst and in nakedness and in want of all things, and he shall put a yoke of iron upon thy neck until he have destroyed thee. Is this not happening to us, brothers and sisters? Physical yoke, and now this mental yoke. Yahuwah shall bring a nation against thee from far, from the end of the earth, as swift as the eagle. As swift as the eagle flies, right? A nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand. You see that? Every captivity we went in ancient times, we understood the language. We understood the tongue. Right? So we all spoke similar language in those days. Right? But in slavery, chapter slavery, from the Arab slave trade to the transatlantic slave trade, this slave trade was the only slave trade that we were one. We were not together, we were scattered. Right? We did not understand our oppressors. That's why they have also forcefully torture us and whoop us and beat us for them for them to impart, or for us to accept their language, which is English. Because if you notice, with certain people, like from the Caribbean, Jamaica, Haiti, Trinidad, you know what I mean, Barbados, Texas, those places, right? When we speak, we have an accent, right? Because there was a language before the English was forced upon us, and that language is the Hebrew. You understand? Because Jamaican language is a combination of three languages: Patois, which we created to communicate among us Hebrews, Trinidad, Yashuel, right? It's a mix of Patois, Creole, and Hebrew language, brothers and sisters. You know? In English, you guys say, come here. In Jamaica, we say, come here. Come here. Yeah. Yeah, it's a Hebrew word, brothers and sisters. So I like to point out those that do. You know what I mean? Notation. You understand, brothers and sisters? Right? Yahuwah shall bring a nation against you from far, from the end of the earth, as swift as the eagle, right? America has the flag of eagle, the eagle, that's their emblem, right? As simple as the Egypt flight, a nation whose tongue those shall not understand. A nation of fierce countenance, which shall not regard the person of the old, nor show favor to the young. That have been slaves. They didn't care about the young or the old. You're still getting slaves. You're still brutalized and violated. And ye shall eat the fruit of thy cattle and the fruit of thy land until thou be destroyed. Which also shall not feed thee either corn, wine, or oil, or the increase of thine king, or flocks of thy sheep until ye have destroyed thee. And ye shall besiege thee in all thy gates until thy high and fence walls come down, wherein thou trustest throughout all the land, and ye shall besiege thee in all like on all thy gates throughout all the land which Yahuwah thy Elohim hath given thee. And thou shalt eat the food of thine own body, the flesh of thine sons and of thy daughters, which Yahuwah thy Elohim hath given thee in the siege and in the straitness, wherein thy enemies shall distress thee. So shall the man that is tender among you and very delicate, his eyes shall be evil towards his brother, and towards the wife of his bosom, and towards the remnant of his children which he shall leave, so that he will not give to any of them of the flesh of his children whom he shall eat, because he had nothing left him in the sea and in the straitness wherein thine enemies shall distress thee in all thy gates. The tender and delicate woman among you which would not adventure to set the sole of her foot upon the ground for delicateness and tenderness, her eyes shall be evil towards her husband of her bosom, and towards her son, and towards her daughter, and towards her young one that cometh out from between her feet, and towards her children which shall bear. For she shall eat them for want of all things she can eat in seed and straightness, wherein thy enemy shall distress thee in thy gates. If thou wilt not observe to do all the words of this law that are written in this book, that thou mayest fear this glorious and fearful name, Yahuwah thy Elohim, then Yahuwah will make thy plagues wonderful, and the plagues of thy seed even great plagues, and of long countenance, and sore sickness, and of long countenance, or continuance. Moreover, he will bring upon thee all the disease of Egypt, Mizrahim, which thou was afraid of, and they shall cleave unto thee. Also, every sickness and every plague which is not written in the book of this law, then will Yahuwah bring upon thee until thou be destroyed. You see that? This is a joke, right, children of Yisrael? And he shall be less in number, whereas ye were as the stars of heaven for multitude, because thou wouldest not obey the voice of Yahuwah thy Elohim. How simple that is, just to listen and obey, which many of you have a problem today. Celebrities are your God, right? The laws of this world is the law that you treasure and fear. But the laws that can actually save your soul you know. Something that leads to eternal life, you know. And it shall come to pass that as Yahuwah rejoiced over you to do you good and to multiply you, so Yahuwah will rejoice over you to destroy you and to bring you to naught, and ye shall be plucked from off the land whither thou goest to possess it. And Yahuwah shall scatter thee among all people, from the one end of the earth even unto the other, and there thou shalt serve other gods which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone. This is happening right now in and among Israel. Huh? Did not the Most High scatter thee among all nations, among all people, brothers and sisters? Huh? Okay. And among these nations shall thou find no ease. Isn't this so, brothers and sisters? Open your eyes. Isn't this so, brothers and sisters? And among these nations shall thou find no ease, neither shall the soul of thy foot have rest, but Yahuwah shall give thee there a trembling heart, and a failing of eyes, and sorrow of mind. And thy life shall hang in doubt before thee, and thou shalt fear day and night, and shall have no assurance of thy life. That's happening right now. And in the morning thou shalt say, would Elohim it were even? And at evening thou shalt say, would Elohim it were morning? For the fear of thine heart, wherein thou shalt fear, and for the sight of thine eyes, which thou shalt see. And Yahuwah shall bring thee into Mizrahi again with ships. So again, with ships, that means a second time we were in Egypt. The first time, along with numerous captivity, we've been through, I think it's over 70 yards. Don't quote me that, you can go research yourself. Right? But Egypt, see, he mentioned Egypt again. Before the word Egypt means house of bandits, brothers and sisters. Mizrahi means house of bandits. You see. So, the second time in Egypt is the land which we are scattered in. Represents the house of bandits, Egypt, as Malcolm X so firefully pointed out. This is Egypt, this is Babylon. Whether we are scattered, Jamaica, so forth, as Barbados, Trinidad, Guyana, Haiti, spiritual Egypt, house of bondage, brothers and sisters, with ships. You see, this is our ancient biblical Holocaust, brothers and sisters, right? Perpetrated by the British and the Spaniards. By the way whereof I spake unto thee, thou shalt see no more again, and there shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and women, and no man shall buy thee. Right? So we shall see it no more again. What we shall see no more again, brothers, is the land which we were taken from. We will not see it no more, brothers and sisters. Alright? So, let's get into the meat of this mini lesson, I guess, brothers and sisters. You know, these things turn out sometime, you know. It wasn't meant to be a lesson, but you know how I do. Things end up turning into a lesson. That's how this the Ruach HaKodesh work at times, brothers and sisters. Right? Okay, so the punishment of Hebrew slaves in Jamaica. Right? Previous analysis of the punishment of slaves in the British colonies have concentrated on the period after 1780. This article used the mid-18th century records of the slave court of the parish of St. Andrew, Jamaica, to analyze the crimes for which slaves were prosecuted and the judicial punishment they received. Prosecution concentrated heavily on a few offenses, especially theft and running away. Punishments were severe and were largely concerned with the slave's body. They included death, flogging, transportation and bodily mutilation. Some punishment made use of the cotton tree, which figures significantly in Afro-Jamaican cosmology, suggesting that the authorities were trying to harness or combat the power of Obia. You see that? Let me read it over again, brothers and sisters. Right, punishments were severe and were largely concerned with the slave's body. and they include death, flogging, transportation, and bodily mutilation. Some punishment made use of the cotton tree, which figures significantly in Afro-Jamaican cosmology, suggesting that the authorities were trying to harness or combat the power of Obia. Witchcraft, brothers and sisters. The article compares in Jamaican slave court practice of that of British courts in the same period, as well as the experience of slaves under other jurisdictions. The slave court enacted rituals that both dramatize and sustain power relations, while rather than representing the supposed common discipline of all to a single rule of law, as did the contemporary British spectacle of the trial and punishment, Jamaican courts practice emphasizes the difference between enslaved and free, valorizing the private penal power of master under slavery. Vincent Brown, right? University of Warwick, right? May 12, 2010. In his 1801 History of the British West Indies, the Jamaican planter and slave owner Byron Edwards, admitting that in countries where slavery established, the leading principle on which the government is supported is fear, or a sense of the absolute coercive necessity, which leaving no choice of action supersedes all questions of right one. Yet slave masters did not achieve the fear requisite to maintaining control over the enslaved by physical force alone. They did in fact assert their right to rule, and they did so by trying to terrorize the spiritual inclinations of the enslaved. To do so, slave masters projected their authority symbolically through spectacular punishment committed upon the bodies of the dead. As anthropologist Catherine Verdery has noted, dead bodies carry great symbolic weight. They evoke awe, uncertainty, and fear associated with cosmic concern, such as the meaning of life and death. Moreover, when managed with political intent, the corporeality makes them important means of localizing a claim to employing dead bodies for symbols. Masters mark territory with awesome icons of their power. The use of spectacular terror to capture the imaginations of the enslaved remain a staple feature of social control in slave society. Yet even more menacingly, managers and overseers extended this spectacular to the magical, as they tried to harness the active power of the dead and awe of the afterlife to their material authority. Though the intent was to dominate the imagination, the routinization of terrifying spectacles only aided the creation of new knowledge, novel understanding of the relationship between dead bodies, haunting spirits, and political authority that could also enhance the sacred authority of those opposed to serving the plantocracy as slaves, and who were willing to rise up and strike their masters for their part. The enslaved established competing discourses of authority by invoking the spirit of the dead, and by selectively appropriating the material and spectacular and spiritual power of the masters of their own. Vincent is a post-doctoral fellow at the Charles Warren Center, Harvard University, Cambridge, Massachusetts. Right? Slavery and Abolishment, Volume 24, Number 1, April 2003, page 24 to 53. Brothers and sisters, you see the brutality of these oppressors, right? They believe they're just going to skate away and get away with whatever they did to us. No, because we pay for all sin of our forefathers, so they should pay for theirs, and they will pay for theirs. Right? So without further ado, brothers and sisters, watch this video. Blessed love.
Don't know much biology. Don't know much. In a previous video on the Atlantic slave trade,
we saw that about 12 million slaves were brought from Africa. Only 5% of those went to the United States?
50%, 10 times as many, went to the Caribbean, to places like Haiti, Cuba, Jamaica, and Guadeloupe. How do you explain that so many more came to the Caribbean than the United States, when we tend to think of the U.S. as so much a larger country today? Well, the reason is partly...
in Jamaica. But let's just talk about and set the stage for Jamaica's 1831 revolt against slavery. Place us in that time period, if you could, between the Haitian Revolution and the Civil War. How ubiquitous was slavery in Jamaica at the time? I mean, I think I read in your book 9 out of every 10 Jamaicans were enslaved, so that's an incredible figure. Just give us some broader context and then we can begin to narrow things down.
Sure. At that point, British slavery was in its 330th year. It was a lasting and an extremely profitable institution for the empire. They raised sugar as a monoculture. That is to say, that was really the only thing going on in Jamaica, was the production of this nutritionally worthless product, which nevertheless fueled an addiction back in the mother country. And in order to raise it, required this unspeakably cruel institution, which was multi-generational in nature, which required fear and torture to sustain it. And what had happened was that missionaries, Christian missionaries from the mother country, Baptists and Methodists primarily, had finally gained entrance to what were called the Sugar Islands, and began to spread the dangerous message that people can be free. People can be free in a spiritual sense. And this bled over into a more political message that we can be free in a material sense.
And I want to touch on that, because that was an incredible dynamic that you laid out. But let's back up a little bit to talking about how the British seized Jamaica in the first place in the 1600s, and how that kind of set up an economy and an infrastructure for what we saw 200 years later.
Sure. When Britain deposed its king and appointed Oliver Cromwell, the Lord Protectorate, he had an aggressive foreign policy, in particular something that he called the Western Design. Comparisons with the modern day are always, you know, tricky, but, you know, this might be compared to, you know, the U.S. going into Iraq. This was this patriotic thing that we're going to seize the Caribbean islands from the Spanish. And the seizure of Jamaica was kind of a comic opera. Nothing went right, but they stumbled into a military victory and claimed what happened to have been for them one of the most profitable islands in the Caribbean. And that was where you really saw slavery ramped up into a commodity level concern.
So, I mean, there were the twin, I guess, commodities of slavery and the role that Jamaica played in that, which I want to ask you about, and sugar. Would you say those were the two primary fundamental economic drivers in Jamaica for Great Britain?
No question. Those were the twin foundations of the economy.
And so then talk a little bit more about the slave trade and Jamaica's role in the slave trade.
Sure. Jamaica was what was known as the slave depot of the Caribbean. That is to say, that kidnapped human beings from Africa were taken primarily first to Jamaica and then traded throughout the rest of the British possessions in North America, what would eventually become the United States among them. And so the harbor at Kingston and Port Royal was the first site of the New World that a newly enslaved person was going to see. And, you know, there are reports, really vivid, heartbreaking reports of a kind of a catatonia that would descend upon those who were entering a horrific new life at that point. You know, they had already survived the Middle Passage, and what they saw in front of them was this riotous explosion of verdure, the whips, gangs, this new language. Many enslaved people were afraid that the white people were going to drink their blood. It brought a sense of overwhelming depression, quite understandably so, among those who were exposed to this atrocity.
Well, I mean, your first chapter of your book describes Jamaica as the suburb of hell, which, given the description of the heat, of the brutality, of the frequency with which slaves would be killed within years of them arriving and being brutally forced into labor, of course, for years until they were seen as too old or too useless, not even allowed to breed because it was cheaper to import slaves. I guess just if you could emphasize and, you know, talk about some of the practices that made it so brutal, specifically in Jamaica.
Sure. You mentioned a suburb of hell, and that's what some folks in Britain were calling Jamaica, actually. There was never a unified enthusiasm back in the mother country for this practice. There were jokes, for example, about the bricks of the city of Liverpool, which was Britain's greatest slave trading brokerage city, that those bricks were sealed with men's blood. The image of a West Indian trader, which was, of course, a euphemism for slaveholder, becoming a person of obnoxious, vulgar wealth. You know, that was a stereotype. And you know, there's a lot of truth to it, you know, throughout British society, that these folks who had profited from this atrocity were ridiculously wealthy, gold-plated coaches, more wealth than the British monarchy. Jamaica itself was regarded as kind of a Wild West, a place where statistics showed that if you were a young white man going, and they were almost all men, going to make their fortune in this atmosphere, that you could, you would have an income that was 57 times that of one of your compatriots who had gone to New England.
Wow.
Yeah.
I mean, but a bit of a new money dynamic, right? Where seen as gaudy, seen as ostentatious, and, you know, of a lower brow as well.
Correct. I mean, again, a rough comparison, not completely accurate, but you might think of the way that a well-bred Bostonian of the, you know, early 20th century might look at, you know, an oil tycoon from Texas. Great wealth, but you know, the perception of a lack of breeding, a lack of in morality for many Britons who were never quite comfortable with the enslavement of kidnapped human beings.
Right. It was not genteel, I guess. And you mentioned Cromwell earlier. I wanted to ask, and of course, the English Civil War. What was a difference that you observed or that there was between British imperialism under Charles I versus under Cromwell after he took over?
Sure, that was a brief period of exuberance and of jingoism and British foreign policy. And the shape of the Caribbean today can be largely attributed to the consequential events, you know, in that decade, where who was going to be the colonial masters of what island was shaken out.